biology, physics, economy, agriculture, policy and so on, to cover the full field of biomass economy. That's a very short few activities. We are publishers of this book. This is a book of the National Business Directory for Innovative Biomass Plastics and Composites Materials. It's available as PDF, as book, as app for iPad and so on, and also as online database. You see here, you can have 100 categories to identify your right partners in plastics, in food packaging, in almost everything, in automotive industry, and it's downloaded 50,000 times, and the new edition coming soon. So if you are interested, please get in contact with me. And now the last slide about our activities is the coming conferences. We have the world biggest conference on CO2 utilization. You know, CO2 as a feedstock. That means on the one hand algae and bacteria, for example, but it also means artificial photosynthesis, where you can use CO2 directly without any crops for chemicals, for example. And the other big conference is our wood plastic composite conference in Germany. But now I come to the results of our study. Two slides on the background and then the results. The idea was to make the most comprehensive study on biopolymer markets in the world. And we saw in the existing studies a lot of weaknesses. Often the studies was only about a packaging or some subsector. So we tried the first time to make a really comprehensive study. And we financed the study by something we call, we call it industrial crowdfunding. So we asked a lot of companies to pre-finance the study, and this really works. So here you see 26 companies or associations worldwide we could convince to pre-finance the study, because the study took 2.5 years, and this is not easy to finance. And getting the money after 3 years only. And from North America, we had the Ontario Bio Auto Corps from Canada as financing the study. No company from US, but from Asia, North, South America, and Europe, most of the companies. And this is the expert team. There are a lot of experts from our own team, but we also had additional experts to cover North America, Asia, South America, and so on. You see here the number of different experts. And so I think we was able to cover almost all producing biopolymer companies in the world. And the main thing was to have interviews and questionnaires with the companies. But of course, we also looked to a lot of studies. We really collected in this 2.5 years, 5,000 studies, but in detail we analyzed 50 studies. We had 180 vis-à-vis expert interviews on CEO level mostly. And finally, this is the first table with results. We could identify in total about 247 companies in the world producing bio-based polymers at 363 different locations. And in detail, we have detailed data from 114 companies at 135 locations. Here you see the different polymers which was covered in the study. And you see for each polymer group the producing companies here and also the different locations for these polymers. Of course, I have not time to go to all single polymers here, but you see we also covering cellulose acetate. This is forgotten in many other studies. We also covered thermosets, is also overseen in many studies. And of course, most of the polymers shown here are not biodegradable. Biodegradation was not a criterion in our study. Bio-based was the main focus, of course, including biodegradation. What we also did, we try to make a picture from the biomass. We are building blocks to the final polymers. You saw these 26 companies supporting the study. They came mainly, of course, from the polymer business, and they're asking us very often in the study, what is the combination, which building blocks are in the process before our polymers and so on. And they asked us to make this picture here. And there's also no time to go in detail, but I have a summary here you can get from me where all the pictures are in. And also another information, all the pictures you can download in high resolution from our webpage. So you have not to make screenshots or pictures, you can just take the high resolution from our webpage. I cannot go to details here, but you see here in the middle, you have starch, lignocellulose, rubber, plant oils, for example. And then you go for the different steps, the building blocks area here, here glucose, sorbitol, for example, isobutylbromide. And in the outer ring, you see the different bio-based polymers covered by the study. And you see, for example, that polyurethane, the PU, there are different pathways to PU. So there's not only from one building, one biomass, one building block, one polymer, but there is a wide mixture. And I think we can talk on this graphic 1 hour, but just to show you, and you can go to details later. And the final result of our study are shown in this picture here. We could identify about 3.6 million tons capacity for bio-based polymers. That's much more than in existing studies. You see here the different shares on the different main polymer groups. And you see also that there is a forecast. The forecast is only done by the forecast of the producing companies. So we identified these companies we saw in the table before, and we asked the companies for their forecast for their own production and investment. And the result was that to the year 2020, the capacity could increase to about 12 million tons. And you see the biggest share here is bio-based PET. It's the biggest share in the graphics, but also other polymers like PHA or PLA. PLA is the green one here. PHA is this violet here, purple one. Show also a growth times 2, 3 or more. So there are, compared to bio-PET, smaller, but the increase is also very big. So this is this picture. The next picture, we're only showing the bio-based content because depending on the different polymers, you saw this in the table before, I forgot to mention it. In this table, we show also the average biomass content in the polymers. So this PLA, PHA is 100, but this PET, for example, it's 30 to 35%. So if you take this in account and you make a picture only with the bio-based content, then of course the total is lower, of course. And you see also that then PLA and PHA have a bigger share compared to the other feature. Here only the biomass content is taken into account in this feature here. The next slide, we try to give a total overview, because when we talk normally only about construction polymers, also structural polymers here, but we have also rubber, we have man-made fibers, we have functional polymers for coating, for example. And this picture shows the first time the full picture, and you see in all the different subgroups the bio-based share. When we talk about our structural or construction polymers, it's 1.5%. I show on the next slide in detail. But in other subgroups, the share is already higher. In rubber, it's 43%, man-made fiber, 7%. And in functional polymers, 22% because of the starch polymer. Starch is used as functional polymer. And in total, if you have really all polymers together, you have already a bio-based share from 8.2%. The next shows, normally we talk about this structural polymers, and in 2011, we have in total 235 million tons. The share of bio-based is 3.6, that means 1.5% of all structural polymers are already today bio-based. So the old data, that is only 0.3% or something like that, are really now old data. Now we see it's already 1.5%. And when we look to the forecast for 22, we are expecting that the total amount of structural polymers will increase to 4 million tons worldwide. The bio-based to 12, so the share will come from 1.5 to 3%. That means that the increase, the investment in bio-based polymers is double, is bigger than in the total polymer sector. some information on regions. We see in 2011 the shares of the different regions, North America, South America, Asia, and Europe. And the trend is clearly to see that that new investments will take place everywhere, also in North America and Europe, of course. But most of the investments going to Asia and to South America, both have a bigger share in the future. And in Europe and US, the share is lower. But nevertheless, there will be big investment in all regions, but more in Asia and South America due to the existing plans of the companies today. So the full study costs €6,500, is mostly 400 pages thick, is including also database access. So we put all the data we found in a huge database, and this database will be continuously updated. So every month we have an update for the database. One time a year, next time, 2014, the full report also will be updated. And as I told you already, all features from the press release and from my presentation you can download here for free. The report is also containing a lot of more information and features. I will not go in detail here because of time limitations. What is important to see is, for example, here on Field A, you see for the different regions, the different forecasts, you see the applications. So this is the applications for PLA we found. Packaging is still number one, but in textiles, in all kinds of textiles, is already the second. And then we have, again, packaging, rigid packaging, flexible packaging. So this is a very detailed overview of the application. And you see also for all the different PLA producer, you see the capacity over the years from 2011 to 2020. Some are marked black because the companies are not allowing us to show the features, but for most of the companies, you can see, find the database, very detailed data. Then you find for every company a profile. Here is BioAmber, for example, about the history of the company, location, which features they are using. Very detailed information for about 150 companies. And the last point is that there are trend reports from 6 experts on different issues. You can see here on market development, from building blocks, from very different perspectives, especially interesting from Jan Rabenstein and Wolfgang Walter from Netherlands and Thailand. The last slide shows one additional information. You saw here we have also one trend report on green premium prices. And this is very interesting because the question, is the market ready to pay green premium prices for biobased? It's a big question. And we made a big survey on that. It will be published, the full, this special report we published in September. In this study, it already the first results included. So we saw that the market in general is, in most of the cases, business customers accept if there is any green pull from the market, 10 to 20% green premium prices. So you can expect for many customers that pay 10 to 20% more. The definition of green premium is for the same technical performance, but increased emotional or strategic performance. That is the definition of green premium for us. And it was also very interesting to see that in specific markets, you can also find green premium prices between 50 and 100% and even higher. And this is only in very specific cases. One example is the bio-MEG, which is used for the bio-PET production of Coca-Cola. The bio-MEG is 100% more expensive than fossil-based MEG just because it's bio-based. And we see other examples here also. So it's really very interesting for investment to see in which sectors, under which condition, you can get a green premium price for your bio-based products. And now the final slide I want to show today. We see on the one hand the natural photosynthesis and the biomass production here. On the other hand, we see also that the artificial photosynthesis is coming also strong. Panasonic introduced earlier this year a running machine which uses CO2, water and solar and catalyst to direct production of biomass. without any crop bacteria or allergy in between, just a pure technochemical system. And we think that in the next 10, 20 years, we should perhaps talk about solar chemicals that use in fuels, which come over natural photosynthesis in crops or algae, bacteria or fungi, or they come directly from artificial photosynthesis, but they have both in common that they're using only solar energy, CO2 and water to produce almost all chemicals and polymers in the world. Thank you for your attention.
Was you had a slide that showed an increase in production for different resins through 2020, and everything seemed to be in the positive. Were there any materials that you found that there actually will not be an increase, but there'll be a decrease?
No, we couldn't find a decrease. There are some which have no real increase, like cellulose acetate, they almost stay stable, but we have no decrease.
Question? Could you please identify yourself?
Yeah, hi, Michael. James Kahn with Braskem. I'm really interested in your work on premiums and how you kind of split it out. And also, were you able to identify any individualities between regions on what people are willing to pay for premiums? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thank you for your question. Also, thank you for supporting our study. Some in your company has received the full report already. Green premium. We mainly look to Europe and US, and we collected about 50 examples from customers to identify green premium. We could not find green premium in Asia, except Asian companies producing for US market or for European markets. So it's mainly Europe and North America. Of course, we also talked with Braskem, but the main customers also both in Europe and North America. So this is mainly due to this. And what was really surprising in the first view, normally you expect that the highest green premium is close to the end consumer. Yeah? And sometimes it's the case. We found some examples in packaging for bio supermarkets, for organic supermarkets. And there is really the highest bio-based green premium near the consumer. But in the bio-MEG case, it's the other way around. Yeah? And the highest green premium is on the building block, and down to the consumer is almost nothing. Yeah? So we found both situations where the highest is in the building block and the highest is the end consumer. But these are very specific situations. In most of the cases, we have 10 to 20%. But also what's interesting, established companies producing biopolyamide since 50 years, they can find no green premium at all. We only see green premium if they're linked to a new investment. Yeah? So the bio-MEG producer will never invest if the customer Coca-Cola is asking for bio-MEG. So you can only find green premium in new investments if you have an old biopolymer produced in 50 years. You cannot go to your customer and say, hey, I'm bio-based, I want 10% more. The customer will not pay that. So it's a very complex situation with green premium, but it's important that there is a green premium market.
Michael, Edwin Tam, Techno Apex. Thank you for the study, it's very impressive. I have two questions. First question, I didn't see any breakdown between the biodegradable and bio-based, and what's the forecast for that one? That's question number one. Question number two is I see the region, and I see a big chunk coming from Asia. And what's the reason for that? Thank you.
So for the first question, we see a bigger increase in non-biodegradable plastics. They have higher increase than the biodegradable. I think the reason is very simple. That's last 10 years, the price difference between bio-based and fossil-based was very big. And so you need additional arguments like biodegradation to sell. But in the future, the price difference becoming lower and lower, and you find very nice new polymers with new properties. So the biodegradation is not anymore the most important point. So we see more increase in the durable biogas plastics. That's the first question. Second question concerning Asia. Yeah, what is the reason? On the one hand, There is in some countries like Thailand, Malaysia, for example, a good access to feedstock. That's of course very important. And the second thing is it's also concerning the political framework. In Europe and in North America, we're doing a very bad job on policy. We financing, we subsidizing the energy sector extremely, and we have no support at all in the biochemistry and the biopolymer sector. And this is really a big hurdle for investment. In Asia, it's in some cases really different. For example, if I would invest today, Malaysia and Thailand have the best political framework for investment in biochemistry and biopolymers. So it's also depending on the policy in the different countries. And I think also in Brazil, there are interesting political frameworks. So I think Europe and US should really change the policy, and then they can again attract more investment in the sector.
Hi, Michael. Steve Davies, NatureWorks. Appreciate the nice work. One more question about the green premium. I'm curious whether you looked at the question of whether there, not whether people will pay it, but whether there is one. Because it strikes us that the question of what, will you pay a green premium is a bit like the old joke, you know, asking somebody, do they still beat their spouse, right? There's a presupposition that they did, if you get what I'm after. And with this question, there's always the automatic supposition that there have, the bio-based costs more. And really, we'd like to see some data that sorts that out, whether that's always true. In our case, prime example, Stonyfield, right? Replaced polystyrene with our NGO polylactides. Their CEO loves to go on record, this is Gary Hirschberg, and say, it's a win-win-win-win. We're saving money. We downgauge versus polystyrene. It's a stronger container, less breakage in shipping. It's cheaper. There isn't any green premium. There's a green savings. And did you get at that at all with polymers that have been out there a little longer? I mean, we've been out 10 years, so we have a little more data in that regard.
It's not easy to give a short answer on this. I think when we published the full report in September, we could also organize some workshop on that because the cases are so different. And the first thing is how to define green premium. As we said, green premium means that the polymers have exactly the same properties, so it's no difference in the behavior of the polymers. It's only a difference in emotions and strategy. And this is already an important point, how to define green premium. And we mainly asked, we asked the consumers. The study was only in business communication level. And we detected many cases where really the customers are willing to pay more for bio-based. For example, I thought this packaging in organic supermarkets. In Germany, the share of organic supermarkets is about 10-15%, so it's a big share of the market. And they say, okay, they want to make the full story, and the packaging, in cases the packaging, for example, is only 1 or 2% of the whole price, they don't care whether it's 4% or 4.5%, and they are ready to make the full nice story about the product, and they are willing to pay extra for bio-based. But we have to go to example from example to example. In the beginning, I hope that there is an easy structure in the results, and there is an easy answer to those questions. But in fact, it's a very complex situation, and it's from zero to really big premium. And to understand the full picture, it's a picture from 20 different pictures. It's not one picture. Yeah? And I think we should take the time after public to discuss in detail, but I cannot give an easy answer now.
Well, thank you. Let's thank Michael one more time.